There have been a lot of great NASCAR drivers over the years, and maybe, hypothetically, one could argue that some of them are objectively better than the others. But that's not what I want to do today. Rather, I want to look at a driver that sticks out a little bit more than the others. And here's where I want to start. There are currently 8 drivers that competed in the Cup Series that have more than 60 wins in their career. They are Darrell Waltrip and Dale Earnhardt, Jimmy Johnson and Jeff Gordon, Bobby Allison and Cale Yarborough, and David Pearson and Richard Petty. I know that comparing all of these different drivers is not necessarily the best idea. You don't have to tell me. But that doesn't mean I'm not going to try, just for a little bit. And what I actually want to start with is a pretty benign statistic. And that is starts in the Cup Series. Now, starts aren't a particularly useful statistic. All it really does is show you how many times a driver has competed, which doesn't prove a whole heck of a lot about how well they competed. But I want to get these drivers in this order, because this is how many wins they have in those starts. Hang on, I forgot one of them. See, for some reason, David Pearson sticks out like a sore thumb if you happen to look at wins this way. There's a very good reason why. Let's look at some different statistics. Here's win percentage in the Cup Series. Guess who's number one? David Pearson. Here's the percentage of times that a driver's finished in the top 5 in the Cup Series. Leading once again is David Pearson. You can look at top 10s as well. It's a little bit closer, but the leader is David Pearson. And in fact, if you look at poles and the percentage of times that someone has started first in the Cup Series, by a long shot, you get the idea. But here's the odd part. Even if you are a NASCAR fan, at least if you're a newer NASCAR fan, you probably don't think too much about David Pearson being particularly great. Here's an example that I found particularly humorous. This was a question that was posted on Reddit just a year ago. It was a poll of who people thought were the greatest drivers of all time. Except in the poll, they left out David Pearson, which isn't a sin, but it is a questionable decision. Okay, it's kind of a sin, but I do believe that there's actually a pretty simple answer as to why David Pearson really isn't at the front of people's minds, or at least fewer people than you'd think, when the topic of great drivers comes about. There are a lot of drivers out there who have, at least in the past, focused on winning championships first and foremost. But that's not really how David Pearson operated. David Pearson won races. And that's it. He won a lot of races. There's a very interesting quote that is associated with David Pearson. "I never went into any race I didn't think I could win." Bold, but actually surprisingly accurate. And you don't have to look back too far to find that this man turned a lot of heads and gained a lot of respect, especially from his peers. And my goal is that by the end of this video, you too will have that much respect for David Pearson. Let's go through some quick background first. David Pearson grew up in Spartanburg, South Carolina, watching local stock car racing. Pearson was always very passionate about racing, and that worked out because he wasn't necessarily going to go into something else. David Pearson once said that when they told me tater started with a P, I knew they were wrong. So he quit school and started doing blue-collar work. He often described himself as just a textile mill town boy. His racing career definitely started out in a similar vein. He used money that he earned working at a body repair shop to buy a Ford coach that may or may not have looked similar to this. Or maybe it looked something similar to this, which he turned into a street rod. The thing is, he kept winning in cars like these, and he got a lot of attention pretty fast. In 1959, he won 14 times at Columbia Speedway. Track officials tore down the engine in his car, thinking that he was cheating, only to find that it was underpowered compared to the competition, and below the maximum spec. So he was just winning on pure skill. For quite a bit of his career, David Pearson was known as the Fox, or rather, the Silver Fox. And that's for a couple of reasons. First, he had prematurely gray hair. But more importantly, he was very cunning on a racetrack. In fact, the former president of Charlotte Motor Speedway and foremost promoter in NASCAR, Humpy Wheeler, once said of Pearson, "You never saw him in a race until the very end, because it's only in that last 10% that he would actually show up. Otherwise, he was back in 8th or 9th, just waiting." It's not like he was waiting for a caution or something stupid like that. He was just waiting to pounce. Now, despite the fact that David Pearson won a lot, it wasn't particularly easy for him, at least compared to some other drivers. And that's because throughout his 28 years in the Cup Series, Pearson basically drove for a wide range of owners with not necessarily the best equipment. To be blunt, he didn't have the benefit that was petty enterprises. He just had to race his ass off. That part didn't really matter too much to him. Suppose he was used to it. One of the reasons you may not hear of Pearson a lot is probably down to his personality. He was often described as shy, stoic, and subdued. Quite a huge contrast to a lot of athletes, especially now, but even then. But don't let that fool you. If there's one word to describe David Pearson, it's cool. Maybe smoking isn't the best idea anymore, but it's hard to deny that taking a smoke break while driving a car at 200 miles per hour is impressive. It didn't matter for David Pearson. Somehow he was so relaxed while racing that he actually needed something else to do to occupy his time. He didn't need adrenaline to race well. He just raced well. How well did he race, you ask? Well, David Pearson's career started in 1960. He actually went out and bought a car from Jack White, racing 22 times that year. He only finished 23rd in points, because didn't race the full season, but was still voted as the Rookie of the Year. He even had a second place finish at Gamecock Speedway in South Carolina, a fourth place finish at Hickory Motor Speedway, and a fifth place finish after starting on the pole in Spartanburg. He actually started racing this number 3 car in 1961. It was a car that was prepared by, get this, a guy named Ray Fox. But Pearson wasn't even racing at that time. Actually, in 1961, Pearson bent the frame of his car and had to go work as a roofer to support his family. But Ray Fox needed a replacement driver, and who better to do it than David Pearson? His first race in this car was at the World 600 at Charlotte Motor Speedway, the longest race on the calendar. Pearson ended up qualifying third for the race and led after the first round of pit stops. In fact, his only competitor was Richard Petty, who blew an engine on lap 311. But then this happened to David Pearson. He ran over some debris on the back stretch with just two laps to go. while in the lead. First glance, it seems like an absolute disaster, right? Yeah, it kind of always is. Except, David Pearson was leading by three entire laps at this point over Fireball Roberts, who was coming fast. But Pearson still managed to limp his way all the way around the track for a mile and a half as Fireball Roberts just tried to keep catching up. He had a lot longer distance to go, but even though David Pearson was going around the track at just 20 miles per hour, he still made it across the line in first for his very first win in the Cup Series. Oh, and by the way, in his second start in that number three car at Daytona, he also won. Notice how I said that Pearson's only competitor is Richard Petty? Just so you know, Richard Petty's name is going to come up a lot. The next couple of years for David Pearson were pretty quiet. 1962, he started only 12 events, but still finished 10th in points. Now, he was bouncing around a few teams at this time, including racing for Cotton Owens, Bud Moore, and even Julian Petty, who is related to Richard Petty. 1963, he was 8th in points, starting 41 out of 55 races. He got two poles, but he didn't win anything that year. But then 1964 happened. Pearson was gearing up to race a little bit more. In 1964, David Pearson won 8 separate times at 8 different tracks. Also ended up on pole at 12 different events. In terms of points, he ended up finishing 3rd, behind only former champion Ned Jarrett and first-time champion Richard Petty. This year is effectively the very first time that Richard Petty and David Pearson went head-to-head. Now, let's really bring out the rivalry here, shall we? On paper, this still looks like a pretty even season in a lot of ways, except for maybe top fives and number of laps led, average start, and average finish. But this is still 1964. There is no shortage of opportunities for these two, who, one could say, were the toughest competitors of the time. Especially considering that Richard Petty, if you remember, got 200 wins. But one of these drivers has a few more tricks up his sleeve. 1965 was an odd year. And once again, the careers of Pearson and Petty are kind of intertwined. NASCAR banned the Mopar Hemi engine, which basically made the cars that Petty and Pearson were driving pretty damn uncompetitive. So they skipped out on a huge chunk of the year, until head of NASCAR at the time, Bill France Sr., had to undo the rule and make sure that his up-and-coming heavyweights wanted to come back to the Cup Series. Out of the 14 events that he did drive that year, Pearson still won twice. And now, it's 1966, and Pearson decides to race another full season, and also decides to do just a little bit better. Out of the 49 events that Pearson raced that year, he won 15 of them. Early in the year, Pearson won at Hickory, Columbia, Greenville Pickens, and Winston-Salem, all in a row. And by the end of the year, he had enough points to win his first championship. And believe me when I say, he just didn't have any competition. Here is the season that David Pearson put together. Along with those 15 wins, 26 top fives, 33 top tens, 7 poles, an average finish of 6.4. Here's how everyone else did. You'll notice that maybe besides one guy that seems to keep coming up, no one else did anything second place with zero wins. And yet, that's the only driver that came within 12,000 points. Let's think about it this way. Second through 10th in points, nine separate drivers were able to win 14 races that year. The only people remotely close to David Pearson in terms of performance that year. David Pearson, by himself, won 15 times. It's hard to find a category that he isn't first in. Wins? Of course. Top fives? Sure is. Top tens? First there too. Laps led? Maybe a little bit closer, but still first. Average finish? Absolutely. This is a chart of drivers who had won 10 or more races in a Cup Series season before 1966. This is what the chart looks like after 1966. This is David Pearson just getting started. In 1967, Pearson went back to running a partial season, 22 out of 48 races. He also switched racing for Cotton Owens to racing for Holman Moody, mainly because Dodge decided to stop racing in NASCAR, and Holman Moody raced Fords. David Pearson still had two wins that year. A different driver had a slightly better season that year. In fact, Richard Petty set the current NASCAR record of 27 wins in a season, including 10 in a row. This was not going to happen again, mainly because David Pearson started racing more again. Welcome to 1968. David Pearson decided to run another full season. 15 wins weren't enough for David Pearson anymore. He ended up with 16 this year. And added another 12 pole positions to his record as well. As with the last time that he ran a full season, he won himself another championship, even though someone else won 16 races that year. Here are your top three drivers and points for the 1968 Cup Series season. Or rather, here are the two drivers that we actually want to focus on from the 1968 season. I think you'll notice once again that at first glance, we have ourselves a very tight competition here. But looking at the stats, when it comes to wins, yeah, these two both got 16. Top fives? Well, Pearson got the upper hand. Top tens? That was David Pearson again. Poles? Another tie at 12. Average start and average finish? Now, there was only one driver ahead in both categories, and his name is David Pearson. When Richard Petty got to race by himself, he could win a lot. When he had to race alongside David Pearson, let's just say Richard Petty didn't have the best of times, along with every other driver. And Pearson wasn't done there. He still had another full season to run in 1969. Over 51 races that year, David Pearson racked up 11 more wins, and a third championship. At this point in NASCAR history, there was only one other person who had ever gotten three. Lee Petty, Richard Petty's father. Earlier in the year, David Pearson at the Daytona 500 was the first person ever to qualify at over 190 miles per hour. By the end of the year, he was still on top. I don't even have to get rid of a driver to see how Pearson did against Petty this year. And once again, for the third year now, you can see how well David Pearson does in some of the most important categories. He starts up front, stays up front, and finishes up front. And even more than that, just take a look at the average finish that he's able to put together over a year. This is 51 races in which he almost guarantees a top five every single race. To put this into perspective, remember that year where Richard Petty got 27 wins? His average finish was only 0.3 positions better. So far, over the course of David Pearson's career, despite him only racing 4 full-time seasons, in those full-time seasons, he finished 3rd. First. And then first again, for an average of 1.5. But after 1969, he never raced a full season again. He was so good at winning championships, and then just stopped racing for them entirely. In 1970, he only raced 19 times. At the Daytona 500, he was leading with 13 laps to go, but the team changed 2 tires on the car, and he lost to someone who had made a 4-tire stop. The only time he won was at Darlington, and he also got 2 pole positions that year. 1971 was the last year that Pearson raced for Holman Moody, after they asked him to take a 10% pay cut. Yeah, no. Before the split, he still won 2 races and finished 2nd 4 separate times. And then it was 1972. By this time, RJ Reynolds started sponsoring the sport, and it became the Winston Cup Series. The seasons got way shorter, and David Pearson had himself a new team. But not just any team. Wood Brothers Racing. And with Wood Brothers Racing, David Pearson had one of the best stretches of races in the entire history of NASCAR.
What you say? That you only meant well, of course you did.
One could argue that the reason David Pearson and the Wood Brothers were so good together was that the Wood Brothers trusted David Pearson a lot. Basically, with Pearson, if the car wasn't running right, the team knew that it wasn't the driver, and they were going to get to work on it. Pearson knew the perfect line to take on track, and if the setup wasn't right, he'd just take a different line. And once the setup was right, David Pearson was going to go and win. He didn't compete a lot with the Wood Brothers, but he knew that he really didn't have anything left to prove. He was just trying to make money to support his family. And he did. The year of 1972 was a very good start for Pearson and Wood Brothers. In just the 17 races that Pearson entered that year, he won 6 different times, and he ended up 20th in points still. This is the end of the Winston 500 at Talladega Super Speedway. The two guys in front of Pearson crashed into each other, and he got himself a free win. Of course, he also won at Daytona later in the year at the Firecracker 400, a race that he'd go on to win 3 straight years. And then there was 1973. I could really only come up with one good way to describe 1973. was simply one of the best years that anyone has put together in the history of the Cup Series. Here are the point standings for the top 12 drivers that year in points. There are some solid performances in this bunch, but as you should know already, someone else did better. He finished 13th in points. There's one really important bit about David Pearson's statistics. And that is 18 races, 11 wins. David Pearson was named Driver of the Year in 1973, despite starting only 18 out of 28 races. And, as you saw, that's because he won at Rockingham, Atlanta, Darlington, Martinsville, Talladega, Dover, Michigan, Daytona, in Atlanta again, and Dover again, and Rockingham again. In fact, in the first Rockingham race, Pearson led 499 out of 500 miles, only giving up the lead for a pit stop. While racing up to 10 less races than the competitors in front of him in points, he still put up the most dominant season out of any of them. David Pearson's 1973 was just one of those years that's never going to be beat again. His win percentage was 61.1%. The only time that that's been bested was the very first year, when because one driver won the only race he entered. When David Pearson showed up to a racetrack in 1973, he had a better chance of winning that race than you have right now of flipping heads on a coin. Indeed. If David Pearson could have raced 48 times in 1973, the same amount that Petty did in 1967, Pearson would have won 29 races, not 27. 18 races, 11 wins, 5 more than anyone else, 14 top fives, just 2 behind the high that year, 8 poles, 2 better than anyone else, over 2,600 laps led, only bested by Cale Yarborough, in an average finish of 7.8, an average start of 3.4, blowing everyone else who competed that year out of the water. 1974 was actually another very impressive year. Pearson raced 19 times and won another 7 races. He even finished 3rd in points because for some reason NASCAR decided to have the points calculated based on how much money you won, which, as you remember, David Pearson was basically only racing for money at this point and only entering the races with the biggest purses. He also had 11 poles that year. But these things aren't even the most impressive thing that David Pearson did in 1974. And guess what? Richard Petty's involved again. The 1974 Firecracker 400 at Daytona. This is with 2 laps to go. It's just Pearson and Petty. Pearson has the advantage, but not by much. Pearson, being as good as he is, knew that that wasn't going to cut it. He pulls down the track. He waves by Richard Petty. Everyone thinks that Pearson's engine is blown and that he's lost the race. Little did they know, Pearson hadn't lost anything. Instead, Pearson gained something. The draft off Richard Petty's car. With just half a lap to go, David Pearson closed up this entire gap to Richard Petty. And at the very last moment, time when David Pearson is at his best, he got by. And he took home the trophy. 1975 was, in comparison to the last two, a pretty quiet year. He won 3 races out of the 21 that he entered. But there were a lot of other close finishes that probably should have been wins. This is the 1975 Daytona 500. Pearson was leading on lap 177 and had a pretty solid advantage. Richard Petty wasn't actually in this fight. He was 8 laps down. But he began drafting with the second place car, Benny Parsons, so that Benny Parsons could get by David Pearson. And then Pearson collided with Cale Yarborough on the backstretch, and he lost his shot. Did Richard Petty try to screw over David Pearson? Considering Petty was embarrassed the last time these two were at Daytona? I'll leave that one up to you. 1976 fared quite a bit better for David Pearson. He won 10 races again, and finished 9th in points, even though he only raced 22 times. He had the most poles that year with 8, and the best average finish again at 6.9. But even with all that, there was one race in particular that really punctuated David Pearson's career. This is the 1976 Daytona 500. There are only two cars in this fight, with just two laps to go. Richard Petty and David Pearson. Like many super speedway races before this, Pearson knew what he needed to do to get by Petty. He needed to make one slingshot pass and make it stick, and he would go home winning his very first Daytona 500. With only two turns left, just a few hundred feet down the backstretch, Pearson gets by, but just barely, giving Petty just enough time to make another run past him. But they're racing a little too close and a little too hard. But they were both only a few yards away from the finish line. All someone had to do was drive to it.
He'll take the checkered flag. No, he did not make it. He is less than 100 yards from it. Here comes Pearson. Pearson is going to try to make it across the finish line. Petty has his car going. Pearson's going to win it. Oh, fashion angle. He wins the race. What a finish for a horse. I've never seen anything like that. It's unbelievable. Unbelievable, because here is Richard Petty, not more than maybe 150 feet from it.
He's got it started up, and he's crossed the finishing line as well.
He did it. He beat Petty Parsons across, so he gets second place.
But well, he's been pushed. There may be an infringement of the regulations there. Been pushed. So it'll be interesting to see what the officials have to say about this. But what a spectacular finish. We'll have to look at that finish again, because it really was a question of Richard Petty and David Pearson really moving in on each other there in the most spectacular manner in the last corner of the racetrack.
For 1977, Pearson got two more wins out of 22 races, racing 22 times again in 1978. Pearson won another four times. That year, he won his 100th Cup race at Rockingham. But the good times weren't always meant to last. At Darlington, there's a miscommunication in pit road, and David Pearson left without left side tires fully attached to his car, and Pearson quit the team after that. Although, one other interesting thing happened in 1979. Once he left Wood Brothers, Pearson was asked to race for Rod Osterlund in the number 2 car for 4 races, replacing their rookie driver. Maybe you don't recognize him from this picture, but you probably do from this picture. At the end of the season, David Pearson was voted as NASCAR's most popular driver for the first and only time. By the time David Pearson ended his Cup career, he finished with 10 wins at Darlington, the track too tough to tame. 9 wins at Michigan, a 2-mile-long behemoth. 8 wins at Daytona, the 2.5-mile super speedway track. 6 wins at Richmond, with a win percentage of over 50%. 5 wins at Bristol, and also 5 wins at Rockingham, and 5 wins at Dover. All tracks a mile or less in length. 4 wins at Atlanta, and another 4 wins at Charlotte, both mile and a half tracks. And also 4 wins at Greenville, Pickens, and Hickory Speedway, which up until 1970 and 1967 respectively were dirt tracks. And also 3 wins at Riverside, one of the few road courses on the schedule. 3 wins at Bowman Gray, which is only a quarter mile in length. And 3 wins at Talladega, which is 2.6 miles long. I know I categorized David Pearson as a driver that stuck out, but I know he would never categorize himself that way. Instead, David Pearson was just a guy from South Carolina doing what he did best. He didn't need to draw attention to himself. He didn't need to boast or brag about his work. He just did it. And he did it well enough that it spoke for itself. David Pearson could have won every single race that he entered. And I can't say that about any other NASCAR drivers. And I won't. Thanks for watching.